and the world was born. Life begins and ends in the dust you form. Faith commanded and the mountain.
What's up, guys? Welcome to Second Students Online. I'm here with Erin, and she has something for me today, but I'm not sure what it is. So
yes, I'm very excited. So we're starting our series called Good Medicine today. So think back to when you were a kid. A lot of times maybe your mom had to force you to take some medicine that was gonna make you better and stronger, but didn't necessarily always taste the best or wasn't always necessarily the most fun to take. So there are a lot of natural medicines, if you will, okay? A lot of things that people do that are good for you, but that aren't always the best. So I got some in my bag over here, and I just thought it would be fun if you would try them and just let us know how it is. Maybe it's something we need to start doing for ourselves. What do you think? What do you think about it?
All right.
It's gonna be great.
I don't want to get sick, but no, I mean, if it's
you won't get sick.
If it'll make medicine, you healthier. Then it'll make me healthier.
Natural medicine.
I'm down to do that.
We'll start with an easy one. One that actually I took as a kid, and one time my mom caught me eating this whole entire bottle of Flintstones gummies.
Okay,
this is a good one.
I ate those as a kid too. Okay. They were like gummy bears to me.
Yeah, they're so good. So take a few. That's a lot. I don't advise eating more than two. Let us know how they are.
Okay.
Yeah.
The red one's really good.
Yeah. Orange.
Orange.
Good.
Orange is really good.
Yeah.
It's probably my favorite out of the two.
It's not bad, right? See, I actually still take gummy vitamins to this day, but a more adult version. But Flintstones are great. Okay, so that was the first one. Pretty easy, right?
Yeah.
It's pretty easy.
Pretty easy.
So another one that it's really healthy, a lot of people do it, and my drill team director actually made us do this right before we would go on stage for a performance for a competition because it's healthy and it's supposed to give you a lot of energy, natural energy. But a spoonful of it maybe isn't the most tasty, but it's good for you. And that is good old honey.
Honey?
A lot of people take spoonfuls of honey. It's really good for you. Girls, it's also very good for your skin if you just want to put it on there at night.
So you're saying I should put that on my skin instead of in my mouth?
I mean, yeah, you can. But we're going to put this on your mouth. In your mouth right now. Okay, try it.
All right.
It's kind of a lot. Ooh. I used to do this, so I know it's not that great. How is it?
Ugh.
Do you recommend that or no?
I mean, it's definitely sweet, but...
Too much.
Is a lot.
Yeah, well now you're going to have a lot of energy. It gives you energy.
Natural energy, right?
Yeah, that's why my drill team director would make us do that.
Okay,
great. So now you have that one.
Great.
A few more. Okay, this one might be not that good.
You're scaring me.
But
you're scaring me.
It's good for you.
Okay.
So a lot of people, I actually put this in my dog's food.
But
it's good for humans too.
Oh, I put that in my hair actually.
Coconut oil.
I do put that in my hair.
It's good for a lot of things.
I've never eaten it though.
But it's also good to take a spoonful of it.
Is it?
I'll get you a little.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, a lot of people do.
I'm not kidding. Paste.
I researched it last time. I'm not kidding. It's good for you, just to make sure.
That's
a
lot.
I just got you a little. Okay. That's fine. You don't have to eat it all.
It honestly looks like Vaseline. Like.
I'm scared.
Ugh. Do I have to do this?
Yep.
Coconut oil.
We have to do it for them to let
them
know.
I'll do it. I'm taking one for the team.
Oh gosh, I'm scared. It kind of smells good, like coconut. So.
Ugh.
How is it? Do you recommend or no?
It tastes like watered down coconut, but the texture is awful.
Like Vaseline.
Like Vaseline, but like way watered down. Ugh.
See? These are things that people say are healthy for you. Don't know why people do this stuff, but they do. Are you gonna start doing that every night or no?
Probably not.
Yeah, probably not.
I'll take the Flintstone gummies, but.
Yeah, okay, so this one is.
More, we have more?
Yeah, yeah, okay, only a couple more. So this one, a lot of people do this every morning. It's the first thing they do when they wake up.
Brush your teeth.
That, but then they take a small swig of apple cider vinegar. Okay, a lot of people say this is really healthy for you. I don't really remember what all it's good for, but apparently it's good for a lot of things. So they have these at the grocery store, if you're interested, pre-packaged little swigs of apple cider vinegar. Now this is a pretty big thing. It's one tablespoon in here, and it has ginger, black pepper, turmeric, and cayenne pepper.
Cayenne pepper.
So I thought it would be cool if you could just try this for us.
All right.
Maybe not the whole thing.
See, I've never tried apple cider vinegar,
but
people say it's really gross.
Smell it.
I don't want to smell it. I'm just going to go for it. Should I just go for it?
Yeah.
How much should I go? How much should I drink?
I don't know. Just like a small sip because I don't want you to get
apple cider vinegar.
Let's see it.
All right, here we go.
Oh, gosh. Is it bad? So are you going to start doing this every morning, too? It's healthy for you.
Good medicine.
It's good medicine, y'all. Okay, let's do one more.
I do not recommend. We have more?
Okay, one more. It'll be the last one.
That one's the aftertaste of that was like.
It has pepper in it. I don't know why, but at least it wasn't straight apple cider vinegar.
Okay.
Okay, last one is the same thing, but this is a beetroot.
Beetroot. Like.
Do you like beet juice?
Like The Office. Like Dwight, like he grows beets and stuff?
Sure.
I don't know. That doesn't help me out at all.
This is beetroot. It's good for you also. Organic. It's good medicine.
It's organic.
Okay, this is the last one for
the
team.
It's like orange.
It's fine.
All right, here we go.
Which one was worse?
That one, definitely.
This one? All right. Well, if you just want to be healthy, take some good medicine, these are some things that you can try. They're not always the best, but they will make you stronger, better, at the end of the day, supposedly. But I do recommend gummy vitamins. They're very good. I get mine at Target, if you're interested.
Yes. Now I'm like ultra healthy, I guess. Yeah. I don't know. But I'm glad we're going through good medicine. It's going to be beneficial to our spiritual growth.
It sure is.
And these are beneficial to our physical growth, I guess. But
that's what they tell us.
Yeah, guys. So we are so excited to go into worship next. We want to encourage you to just prepare your heart. So let's worship together.
This is no performance, Lord, I pray it's worship. Empty words I can't afford. I'm not chasing feelings, that's not why I'm singing. You're the reason for my song. My soul's attention.
Students, I hope that you are having a great day. Welcome to online Bible study. I'm so excited to be with you today as we get to open God's Word and dig into it. It's always exciting. It's always fun to open the Word of God. It teaches us. It helps us to grow. It changes us from the inside out. And today, we begin a brand new series called Good Medicine. So I remember the times growing up, man, when I got sick, my mom would shove this medicine down my throat, and it was absolutely awful. You see, back then, when I was a young kid, we didn't have these like flavored medicine that makes medicine okay. It was all awful, and I love it when my kids act like they're sick. School's just started, and I know before too long, one of my kids is gonna come to me and they're gonna say, "Dad, I don't feel good. I don't think I need to go to school today," simply for the fact that they don't wanna go to school. And I don't see anything wrong with that because when I was a kid, I didn't wanna go to school every day either. Now, I've seen it enough and I've been guilty of it enough to know when a person is lying about being sick or if they're honest. And I would say, okay, if you're feeling sick, let's go right now to the medicine cabinet and let's get you some medicine. They'd be like, no, I feel fine now. I feel fine. So from that, man, if we were to ask my kids, they'd be like, there's not any such thing as good medicine. But today, as we dig in, I want you to see this. I want you to have some good medicine from the Word of God. Some medicine that feeds our soul. Some medicine that lifts us up. Some medicine, man, that heals us, that lifts us up. And that good medicine for you today, I want you to hear this. The good medicine for you today is to know that God defines us, aka we are who God says that we are. So what is good medicine about that? That's a great question. I'm glad you asked. You see, in today's world, there are so many voices, so many things that point each and every one of you to define yourselves, to define who you are, however you want to do that. But I want you to know that God defines you. He made you for who you are, and He has a perfect plan for you. So today we get to dig in to Judges chapter 6 and look at a man named Gideon. You see, Gideon, he defined himself because of the circumstances that he was in, because of what people said around him, and because of how weak that he was. But God comes along and He gives some good medicine and defines Gideon for who he really is and what he is meant to do. So to set the story up, in Judges chapter 6, Israel has been going through this vicious cycle of rebelling against God, otherwise known as sin. They would rebel and sin against God, and then God would put them in a time of oppression, and then the people would cry out to God in repentance to God, and God would have mercy on them, and He would bring them out. He would deliver them out of this oppression. Then we see that cycle happen over and over and over again. And that's where God begins to appoint these judges, these military leaders, these political leaders that would lead the people out of oppression. But when the judges would die, we would see where Israelites go right back to that cycle again and be corrupt. And now we get to where this people group called the Midianites, they have been oppressing the Israelites for 7 years. And they would come in and take everything that they had. They would take their livestock, they would take their food, they would bully them around. And then that's where God calls on this man named Gideon.
So if you would, I would love for you to take out your Bible, or whether you have a smartphone, whatever that is, get that out, and let's look at the Word of God together. Judges chapter 6. Some of you may not know where that is. That's perfectly okay. It's really pretty simple to get to. If you open up your Bibles to the very beginning, it is the seventh book in the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and then Joshua, and then Judges. Judges chapter 6 is where we're going to be, and we're going to read verses 11 through 16. Take a look with me. Let's get started. It says, the call of Gideon, verse 11. Now the angel of the Lord, he came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, the Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor. And Gideon said to him, please, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and given us into the hand of Midian. And the Lord turned to him and said, go in this might of yours and save Israel from the hand of Midian. Do not I send you? And he said to him, please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said to him, but I will be with you, and you shall strike the Midianites as one man. You see, God saw something in Gideon that was not obvious. He saw something that you and I, that we can't see. Verse 12, if you take a look at that, God called Gideon a mighty warrior. He says, the Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor. And that's interesting, because there's nothing in Scripture that would lead us to believe that Gideon is a mighty man, that he is a mighty warrior. There's nothing about me that suggests that I am a strong man, that I am a mighty warrior. But listen here. We don't see through the lens of God. Any person that were to look at Gideon would not see him as a mighty warrior. They would define him as a weak little man. And here's the deal. God saw beyond Gideon's current condition. God saw what Gideon was going to become. And God sees something in you that is not obvious. He sees past your current condition. He sees a mighty man. He sees a mighty woman that is ready to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. He sees you as his own. He says, this is my beloved child in whom I am well pleased. You see, just like God called Gideon, he's calling each and every one of us, me and you, he's calling us to rise up and to be a mighty warrior despite what we think of ourselves or what other people define us as. But it's not that easy, is it? Let's go back and look at verse 11. It says that Gideon, he was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. It seems pretty smart, right? But you would think so, but this was not the typical way that you threshed out wheat. So what was Gideon doing? We see that he was hiding. When you are fearful of something, you hide. I remember a time back when I was a youngster and I made my mom upset one summer day, and she gave me a whooping on the backside, and it didn't really hurt. So I snickered at her, kind of laughed at her, and she didn't think that was too funny. So she looked at me and pointed her finger. She said, you wait till your dad gets home. And immediately fear ran all over my face and all over my body, and I went and hid. You see, when we look at this story, I think we can really relate this to our lives. I know I can. There's been many times when God has called on my name. He said, Mitch, I want you to do this. I think that you need to do this. And I have just ducked my head and hid from God because I was fearful. And there are still times when I hide. If I'm being honest with you, I think a lot of us are hiding right now. We are fearful of what God is calling us to do each and every day, to step out of the bubbles that we live in and proclaim the name of Jesus. You see, it's time for us to take some good medicine. God is calling on you, the mighty warrior, to look up and to tell others about Jesus, to see opportunities in front of you to proclaim the name of Jesus. See, something else I see in myself that I see in Gideon right here in this story, and maybe you see as well, is Gideon doubted God. If we were to look back, it said God tells him, I will be with you. But Gideon responds with this, verse 13. He says, if the Lord is with us, then why are all these bad things happening to us? And how many times have we thought about that? How many times have you heard that question? See, we begin to doubt God's goodness. We begin to doubt that God actually cares for us. And I want to make it really clear for you and for me. If we were to look at Romans 3:23, it says, for we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We all sin. That's you, that's me, that's everybody that you know of. We sin each and every day. And when we sin, that goes against God's perfect nature. And as a Christ follower, you are a child of God. He is your heavenly Father. So here's the deal. A good father is not going to let his children go uncorrected. Are you hearing me? A good father is not going to let his children go uncorrected. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 11 through 12, it says this, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline or be weary of his reproof or correction. It says, for the Lord reproves or he corrects him who he loves. As a father, the son in him who he delights. So when we mess up and we have sin in our lives, when we see these bad things that possibly happen, man, God is correcting us. We can't go on without God correcting us because he loves each and every one of us. Me as a father, when my kids make a mistake, is there correction that happens? Absolutely, there is correction that happens. Is there doubt in my kids' heads right then whether I care about them or whether I love them? I'm sure there is at the time. But for Gideon, man, he starts recounting all these horrible things that had happened. He starts thinking about how God has forsaken them. He has forgot about them. So here's my deal. How about instead of looking at the bad things in our lives, instead of looking at all the negative, we begin to look at the positive and we recount all the good things that God has done for us in our life. You see, negative thoughts bring negative action. Positive thoughts bring positive action. You see, there are times in life when I have doubted God. There are times in life when you have doubted God. And then there's this. Gideon doubted himself. Verse 15, he says, my clan is the weakest, and I am the weakest in my father's household. Gideon saying, hey, can you get somebody else? Can you get my brother who's maybe a little bit stronger, somebody who's wiser than me, and somebody who's bigger? Just get somebody else because I can't do the job. Gideon seemed to think that God could do nothing because he and his family were nothing. And I know there have been many times in my life where I've felt weak, where I've felt that I don't measure up, where I've felt that I felt useless. I've felt that I don't belong, and I would be guessing that many of you have felt that same thing. And I love what 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 says. It says, my grace is sufficient for you. Listen to this part. For my power is made perfect in weakness. You see, through my weakness, and I have a lot of them, see, God's power is perfected in that through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. You see, Gideon's weakness. You see, God was perfecting that so everybody could see how great that God was. You see, God doesn't see the outside. He sees the inside. He sees the heart. He sees you for who you are. You see, what we need is some good medicine for people, for friends to come along and encourage us, to equip us, to say, hey, you are a child of God. For you to come alongside of your friends and the people around you and to encourage them and equip them. You see, that's good medicine. So I want you to hear this good medicine. Listen to this. God believed in Gideon and he believes in you. Did you hear that? He believed in Gideon. I want you to miss this. He believes in you. You see, despite all the negative talk from Gideon, God's confidence in him did not waver. See, while Gideon was hiding in the wine press, God comes to him and says, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. After Gideon questioned God, he reasserted himself and said, go in strength you have and save Israel out of the hand of the Midianites. Am I not sending you? And after Gideon doubted himself, God reassured him. He says, I will be with you, and you will strike down the Midianites, leaving none alone. See, for you, despite our negative thoughts and negative actions, God's confidence in you does not waver. Despite you questioning God's plan for your life, he says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. He has hope for you. He has a future for you. And despite you doubting yourself, God says, hey, I made you in the image of God. See, that's good medicine. We are who God says we are. God defines us. You see, when he was talking with Gideon, he didn't address him as a weak man, as a man who was hiding. He addressed him as a mighty warrior, a mighty man of valor, and he assured him through his words. You see, when God talks to you, when he speaks to you, when he addresses you, he doesn't see you for how you see yourself. He sees you as a mighty warrior, as a mighty woman. He assures you with his words. God defines you, not other people. So I want you to take some of this good medicine as we finish. You guys listen to this. When we allow God to define us, our question marks turn into exclamation points. Did you hear that? When we allow God to define who we are, not other people, but when we allow God to work in our lives and we allow God to define us, our question marks turn into exclamation points. You see, we're to live by faith and not by sight. See, that's good medicine. Man, thank you so much for joining us today. I hope that you had a great time.
Hey, everybody, welcome, and thanks for tuning in today. And I was reminded of a passage in 1 Timothy recently. I was visiting with a young man who's a junior in high school. Great guy. He's pretty popular at school, really successful, really smart, just a really sharp guy. But and he loves the Lord. And one of the things he said to me, he was just real honest. He said, hey, I really want to be used of the Lord, but I don't really see that happening. And I don't really know, what can God do in my life right now? And then he stopped before I could answer. And he said, I know God has a big plan for my life, as I get older and go on to college and all that. And so he began talking about that. And then he came back and he said, I just don't know how God can use me now. And no joke, it was like throwback Thursday in my mind, because I was taken back literally, I know you're going to think I'm really old, but 41 years to a conversation I had with a young man who was also just like him. He loved the Lord. He was passionate about the Lord. I'd been a youth minister for maybe 2 months. And this young man came to my office and he said, Eric, I know you don't know me very well, but he said, I want you to know. He said, God really has been working in my life, and I want God to do something with my life. And he began talking to me about how he'd come to Christ and how he'd been growing in his faith. And he said, but I just don't really see how God can use me. When I'm in high school, he said, I want God to use me. And he said, I know later in my life he will, And when I thought back to that conversation in 1979, and then I realized here we are 40 years later, and this young man has the same concern. It just told me, the things that we deal with, they just kind of go from generation to generation to generation. Here's the good news. Students, listen to this. 20 years from now, people will be asking the same question. 50 years from now, people asking the same question. How can God use me? I'm just a student. I'm just in high school. I'm just in junior high. I want God to use me, but I don't know how that can happen. Here's what I can tell you from God's Word. 1 Timothy 4:12 says this, let no one look down on your youthfulness or the fact that you're young. But then he goes on and says, but by your speech, the words you use, by your conduct, how you live your life, by your love, the way you treat people, by your faith, how you respond to God, and by your purity, the stands you take in your life, the commitments you have in your life, by those areas, it says, show yourself as those who know him. What a tremendous opportunity that you and I have. I'm no longer young. I don't fit the category, right? But you are. You do. You fit that category. When God says, let no one look down on your youthfulness, he's speaking to you. And I want to challenge you to take God up on that challenge. I want to ask you to take first that passage and say, I will, by my life, by my speech, my conduct, my love, faith, and purity, I will show myself as an example to those who believe. Soon after I had that discussion with that young man recently, he said something else to me. Well, just a few days later, he said, I listened to what you said, and I understand that. He said, I'm just real excited about what God's going to do in my life in the future. And I kind of stopped him, and I smiled, but I said, here's the deal. God's working in your life right now. Your ministry is not the future. Your ministry is not defined when you happen to go to college or go into the workforce or whatever. You're in the ministry right now. You're in the preparation ministry right now. Let God prepare you now. That is ministry right now. And let God use you right where you are at. What a great time we have right now to see God do something huge in your life and in my life and the people around us as Jesus shines through our lives.
Heaven thunders and the world